The next day, the great crowd that had come to the festival heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. So they took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him, shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel." Jesus found a young donkey and sat on it, as it was written, "Do not be afraid, daughter Zion. Look, the King is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt." His disciples did not understand these things at first, but when Jesus was glorified, then they remembered that these things had been written of him and had been done to him. So the crowd that had been with him when he called Lazarus out of the tomb and raised him from the dead continued to testify. It was also because they heard that he had performed the sign that the crowd went to meet him. The Pharisees then said to one another, "You see, you can do nothing. Look, the world has gone after him." And then we go to chapter 18, verses 1 to 3, about the betrayal and the arrest of Jesus. After Jesus had spoken these words, he went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to a place where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, because Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas brought a detachment of soldiers together with police from the chief priests and the Pharisees, and they came there with lanterns and torches and weapons. And then verse 12, Jesus goes before the high priest. So the soldiers, their officer, and the Jewish police arrested Jesus and bound him. Verse 28, he goes before Pilate. Then they took Jesus before Caiaphas to Pilate's headquarters. It was early in the morning, so they themselves did not enter the headquarters so as to avoid ritual defilement and to be able to eat the Passover. Then we turn to Luke's account, chapter 12, verses 13 to 24, as Jesus receives his sentence. Pilate then called together the chief priests, the leaders, and the people, and said to them, "You brought me this man as one who was perverting the people, and here I have examined him in your presence, and have not found this man guilty of any of your charges against him. Neither has Herod, for he sent him back to us. Indeed, he has done nothing to deserve death. I will therefore have him flogged and release him." Then they all shouted out together, "Away with this fellow! Release Barabbas to us." This was a man who had been put in prison for insurrection that had taken place in the city and for murder. Pilate, wanting to release Jesus, addressed them again. But they kept shouting, "Crucify! Crucify him!" A third time he said to them, "Why? What evil has he done? I have found in him no ground for the sentence of death. I will therefore have him flogged and then release him." But they kept urgently demanding with loud shouts that he should be crucified, and their voices prevailed. So Pilate gave his verdict that their demands should be granted. We pray for God's blessing upon the reading of his holy word.
Can you hear the roar of crowds? Can you feel the excitement in the air? Jesus is coming. Grab your branches quickly. Spread your coats on the ground in front of his donkey. Jesus is coming. Imagine that. Picture the scene from the first Palm Sunday. Have you ever wondered what exactly it meant? Why is the crowd grabbing palm branches? Begin with, when they hear Jesus coming to Jerusalem for the Passover. Well, I mean, of course, the gospel tells us what Jesus does is a fulfillment of the words of the prophet Zechariah, riding in town on a donkey and all. Jesus wants them to know that, yes, he is one of whom Zechariah spoke. He is the one they have been waiting for. But to really understand the scene, let's turn back almost 200 years before that day. In the 2nd century BC, a Greek kingdom based in Syria, held power over the Jews. Their king was a man named Antiochus. Now Antiochus was the great-great-great-grandson of a man named Seleucus, who was Alexander the Great's infantry general. After Alexander died, his generals split up his world empire among themselves, and this portion had fallen now to Antiochus. For a variety of reasons, King Antiochus decided the Jews needed to stop practicing their religion. They were no longer free to do so. Antiochus banned the ritual of circumcision. He commanded Jews to eat pork. He abolished ownership of the scriptures. He even slaughtered a pig as a pagan sacrifice in God's holy temple to defile. Those were dark days for the people of God. Many gave in and went along with the program. But some did not. There was a band of brothers, sons of a priest named Mattathias. Well, these brothers took up arms and led a revolt. They were called the Maccabees. Judah was their first leader. Judah the Maccabee took back the city of Jerusalem. He had the temple purified, a ceremony remembered by the Jews each and every year since then as a festival called Hanukkah. In time, Antiochus died. Sadly, his nephew Demetrius became king and kept on fighting. Judah died in battle. Now, Judah had other brothers. One of them, especially clever, was a man named Jonathan. Jonathan took up the fight and pressured the Greek general into a peace treaty. Jonathan went on to be appointed high priest and leader of the Jews. Years passed, he made a mistake. He fell into a trap and was taken captive, and he was executed. Then his brother Simon took over the leadership. Simon managed to secure the Jews' freedom from further Greek meddling. The book of 1 Maccabees records all this. It tells us that Simon, who now was high priest, set his sights on Jerusalem all over again. And this book reads, they entered the citadel with praise and palm branches, and with harps and cymbals and stringed instruments, and with hymns and songs, because a great enemy had been crushed and removed from Israel. There it is, the palm branches. That's what is in the crowd's mind here as they see Jesus riding their way. These palm branches they're waving, the songs they're singing, they mean, Jesus, be our new Simon, set us free. They cry out, Hosanna! Hosanna! Save us now! Save us now. Simon's descendants claimed to be not just high priests, but also kings, holding power until the new David might show. Crowds realize, here he is. Jesus is on his way. What did the prophet write? Your king comes to you, triumphant and victorious as he, humble and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. He will cut off the chariot from Ephraim and the war horse from Jerusalem, and the battle bow shall be cut off, and he shall command peace. The nations. His dominion shall be from sea to sea, and from the river to the ends of the earth. The crowd was thinking of this, finally, no more Greek rule, no more Romans rule, no more oppression. Finally, the king who could turn back the tides and set the world at peace, finally, the promised Messiah is here. Let's invite him in. Jesus is the king in triumph, the king in victory. Jesus is Savior and King, coming in the name of the God of all Israel. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. The words of the song. Come on in. Here is Jesus, King of Israel. The crowd spreads the word. What message are they spreading? This is Jesus who raises the dead. This is Jesus who works wonders we've never seen, never even dreamed could happen. This is Jesus, the Son of David, the King long foretold. Everyone, come on out, let's welcome him. Let's celebrate him. Let's be on his side. Now is the time. No wonder the Pharisees were getting pretty nervous. Look, the whole world has gone after him. What an exciting day. Now fast forward for 5 more. Jesus has come into the city and stirred things up. His greediest disciples sold him out for a slave's price. At night in the garden, soldiers arrive to take Jesus away. He doesn't resist. He could have. He makes that perfectly clear. He speaks his identity. I am. The soldiers fall back. If you want to, you can snap his fingers. An army of angels big enough to conquer the world would stop anyone in his path. That's not what he does. He submits. He's taken away. The show trial before the Sanhedrin goes the only way show trials ever go. The next morning, the priests and nobles follow Jesus to the courtyard outside Governor Pilate's fortress. Pilate looks into the matter and realizes Jesus has not come to threaten him. Jesus proclaims a different kind of kingdom. Pilate goes back out, calls everyone back, the chief priests, the rulers, and now the people, the crowd, are invited to come take part in this scene as well. Pilate proposes to give Jesus a slap on the wrist for the sake of peace and then set him free. Herod agrees with him that there are better things for them to be doing with their Friday morning. This is no time for nonsense. We might expect the crowd to cheer. Blessed is the King of Israel! He's free. Pilate wants to set him free. That chant is gone with the wind. That was from 5 days ago. Get me the times. His 15 minutes of celebrity are over, they say. No, Jesus is not the one they want back. Jesus is no longer King. Jesus is this man. Away with this man. Release Barabbas to us, they cry. Barabbas is a rebel. The Romans would call him a terrorist, and with good reason. Well, to the Jewish crowds, maybe he's a freedom fighter, the kind of leader who fight, who might be bloody, but he'll get the job done. But he's a murderer. When you read this story and you see the name Barabbas, think Osama bin Laden. That's what the crowds are crying. We don't want Jesus. We want Barabbas. We want Osama. Let him live. Let Jesus die in his place. Pilate is not fond of that thought. Nor should he. Please, here, Jesus is no real criminal. He's one of you. Take him back. He doesn't deserve to die this way. The crowd cannot be reasoned with. The crowd has turned dark, malicious, cruel. Crucify him! Rings out a cry from somewhere in the crowd. Maybe it was one of the priests stirring things up. Catches on. Crucify him! We hear again. The shout travels like a virus, infecting the entire crowd. Everyone is swept up in the chant. Crucify! 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 Pilate tries to shout over them, pleading as the voice of reason that Jesus needs to be set free. But the crowd cannot be appeased by anything but bloodshed. Crucify! 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 They won't stop until Pilate gives in. Pilate doesn't want a riot on his hands. What the crowd wants, the crowd gets. The crowd wants a crucifixion, so Pilate sends Jesus toward the cross. Where did all those palm branches go? What happened to the loud hosannas? They're left by the wayside in some back alley. They tossed in the trash can, stored on the shelf. In less than a week, the crowd turned from hosanna. Crucify. From blessed is the King of Israel to we have no king but Caesar. How does that sort of thing happen? How could the crowd turn on Jesus so fast? From adoring worship one moment to froth-mouthed condemnation the next. From waving the palm branch and calling him king to wanting him flogged. Bloody, harsh nails hammered through his hands and feet, thorns slicing his forehead to ribbons, hung naked till his heart gives out or he suffocates under his own weight. How does that happen? Well, this is Jerusalem. It is not Athens. As Chesterton said that when paying a visit there a century ago, this is not a university town full of philosophies. It is a Zion of the hundred sieges raging with religions. Not a place where resolutions can be voted or amended, but a place where men can be crowned and crucified. Crowned and crucified he was, thanks to the turning hearts of the mob. And I can think of four main reasons why the crowd handed Jesus over to be crucified in Barabbas' place. First, Jesus proved to have a different idea of what a Messiah looks like. When he came to them, they thought, now here's Simon Maccabee all over again, with the bonus of power to work miracles. They wanted a Messiah who would give them what they wanted, rule by Jews, for Jews, over everyone else. They wanted to turn the tables on the Romans, have Romans wait on their tables, have Romans clean their floors, have Romans look up at them with servile awe. Oh, yes, yes, anything you say. They wanted to lord their worldly supremacy over the Romans as the Romans had done to them. Do to others as they've been doing to you, right? We know that's not the golden rule. But it's the rule the crowd is hoping for. And they're upset to find out that that's not Jesus' style. In fact, do you know the first thing that happens after Jesus gets welcomed in Jerusalem with the palm branches? John continues his account Now there were some Greeks among those who went to worship the festival. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, with a request. Sir, they said, we would like to see Jesus. Yeah, Greeks, as in the people of Antiochus, as in the people Simon Maccabee kicked out. Now here they come to worship, and Jesus welcomes them in. The crowd wanted a Messiah like Simon, a warrior king who makes peace at the expense of the nations. But Jesus is a king who wants peace for the sake of the nations, for us. Peace not made through war, but through worship. Jesus insists that the corrupt temple regime topple. What they have turned into a den of thieves was meant to be a house of prayer for all nations. For everyone. The crowd comes to realize that their problem with Jesus is he doesn't hate all the people they hate. How frustrating is that? To find out Jesus doesn't hate all the people we hate. Jesus does not sign on to their agenda. He makes radical demands. If they want a Messiah in him, he gets to define what that looks like. And they decide that he's not their Messiah. So they drop their palm branches, and Hosanna leaves their lips. Second, the crowd turns their back on Jesus because in their disaffection and weakness of faith, they let their usual leaders lead them away from him. They buy into what the Pharisees, the chief priests, and the scribal class say. And that message is, don't trust this Jesus. You don't know what he's up to. The crowd lets themselves be talked out of blessing Jesus as king because they listen to all these other voices. Not just giving them a hearing, but they give in to them. The crowd denies what they've seen, denies what they've heard, denies what they've experienced, denies what the voice of truth has told them, all to agree with the unreason of those persuasive folks in power. Third, the crowd turns their back on Jesus because once enough people are doing it, everyone else feels the need to go before him. Imagine being embedded in that crowd on Good Friday. To your left, to your right, in front of you, behind you, people shout, crucify, crucify, crucify. Well, you could speak up and try to shout out, no, no, Hosanna, Hosanna. In the middle of the crowd, would it make a difference? Pilate's not going to hear your one little voice. And what might it cost to say Hosanna when everyone else is saying crucify? What is the price of breaking lockstep with the angry mob all around you? What if they turn violent? What if my neighbors shun me? What's safer to go the path of least resistance? To at least mumble, crucify, crucify. Everyone else is here. So the mob stands united. Fourth, the crowd turns their back on Jesus because the crowd is just fickle. That's just what they are. Fickle. Deceitful. Prone to waver with the shifting of the winds. That's the mob mentality. And crowds are fickle because crowds are made up of us. And we are fickle creatures. We like to give in to our impulses and our desires. Self-denial is hard and unpleasant. We would much rather do what we want, when we want, how we want. So for generations, we teach our children, just follow your heart. Do what feels right. Never mind what Jeremiah says, you know, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? The crowd follows their heart. They follow their impulses First a crown came, then a crucified king. Now for all their failings, the crowd starts out by doing the right thing. Maybe not thinking the right way, but doing the right thing in waving palm branches and shouting their hosannas. The priests, the Pharisees, Pilate, they didn't shout hosanna in the first place. The crowd did. Can you imagine if the crowd had clenched their palm branches tighter? If they'd stuck it out with Jesus, shouting hosanna on his terms, not theirs. See, that's where they failed. The moment they dropped their palm branches. Now, we may not have handed out to everyone palm branches so far this morning's service. But the believers' hearts, souls, still wave them all the same. If you're a believer, with hearts and hands and voices, we, as God's holy crowd of his very own children, are waving palm branches, welcoming Jesus into our lives, our worlds, as the one and only Savior King. Jesus is the one who sets us free. Jesus is the one who makes real peace. And all authority in heaven and on earth has been given into his hands, and his kingdom shall have no end. Every day of our lives, we are called to sing our hosannas. Save us, Jesus. Save us now. We look around at danger, the evil, and trouble. We look at the avalanche of our sin rolling out of control. Save us, Jesus. Save us now. We're blind to our own pride, our own greed, our own selfishness. Save us, Jesus. Save us now. We lay loved ones beneath topsoil. Save us, Jesus. Save us now. The world is broken, as twisted as a tornado, breaking everything we hold dear, leaving debris scattered messily through our lives. Save us, Jesus. Save us now. We're sad. We're angry. We're scared and hurting. We're alone and desolate and desperate of heart. Save us, Jesus. Save us now. Save us. Hosanna. Hosanna. In the face of it all, it might be tempting some days. Tempting to give up hope that Jesus will ever answer that prayer. Will ever come and make things right. Instead of singing hosannas in faith, we can surrender to fear and despair. Instead of clinging to our palm branches and waving them high till he comes, we set them aside. Maybe we go looking for our salvation in some other name. Forgetting there's no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. Or maybe we resign ourselves to having no salvation. No rescue, no liberation at all. We just settle for where we are and keep our head down. Throughout the centuries, professing believers have tossed aside their palm branches in all these ways and so much more. Giving up hope, abandoning the faith, trusting in other kings. Imagine religion is a nice compartment of life for Sunday mornings, and we can check our palm branch at the door when we leave. But that's just not so. There is one lesson to learn from the crowd in the Gospels, this lesson. Don't stop singing hosanna. Don't drop your branches. Keep waving them loud and proud. Hold fast, cling tight to what is good. Our hearts may have a fickleness and deceitfulness in this sinful world, but disciples discipline themselves to wave the palm branch no matter what their hearts whisper. And as King Jesus is welcomed deeper and deeper into our lives, well, God sends the Spirit of His Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father! And so Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith as you are being rooted and grounded in love. And so then we live for singing and making melody to the Lord in our hearts, putting hosannas there to stay. The larger crowd of culture insists on shouting crucify. Still we sing, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, blessed is the King of Israel. Hosanna to the Son of David, Hosanna in highest heaven. We refuse to be peer pressured or manipulated out of our commitment to celebrating Christ. Don't drop your branches. Keep them waving, even when Jesus does what you don't expect. Keep them waving, even when Jesus takes up his whip and causes a ruckus, knocking over tables left and right. Keep them waving, even when the kingdom makes demands, when the king tells you to die to self and store up treasure somewhere less earthly. Keep them waving, even when King Jesus tells you to love and welcome your enemies, even those Greeks. Hail King Jesus on his terms, even when his salvation comes in the shape of a cross, beyond which lies resurrection. Hosanna! 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 Amen. Let us pray. Our Father, you sent your Son into this world as the promised Son of David, coming in the name of the Lord with salvation in his arms and love in his heart. Victorious, triumphant, humble, gentle, bringer of peace, and welcome to all. He went and he died on Barabbas' cross, on my cross, on our cross, for our sin. We ask, save us now. And he did. But Lord, we know that the outworkings of that salvation are not finished until he returns and makes all things new. Save us now. Even so, lead, Lord Jesus, come quickly. Come quickly and lead us in the way of peace. Until that time, keep us faithful. Pour out your Spirit into our hearts so that we can always have Hosanna on our lips. We bless and praise you, Lord. And we bow before the King of Kings, our Savior King.